Happy 30th anniversary to the Fire Emblem series. It's been a great ride so far, and I look forward to a bright future for the franchise. With that said, this 30-year anniversary hasn't exactly been the most jam-packed year of Fire Emblem content coming off of the release of Three Houses in 2019. However, Intelligent Systems and Nintendo decided to cap this year off with quite the surprise, announcing a Switch release of the very first game of the series, Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light. While it is likely that if you found this video, you are somewhat familiar with the background for Fire Emblem Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light, I'll do a quick summary for those whose memories need to be jogged. The first game in the Fire Emblem series came out in 1990 for the Famicom in Japan, designed and written by Shozo Kaga, and pioneering the tactical role-playing genre. This game codified the medieval setting, most of the gameplay, and a lot of the writing tropes that the series continues to use to this day. The game stars Prince Marth of Altea, trying to recover his throne and defeat the foes who masterminded the overthrow and murder of his father and have still darker plans for the rest of the continent of Arcanea. The game never made it to the West, just like every Fire Emblem game until Fire Emblem The Blazing Blade in 2003. The game did receive a remake in 2008, 2009 in the West, called Fire Emblem Shadow Dragon for the DS, that incorporated many of the advancements the series had taken in the intervening years. The upcoming December 4th release, though, is for the original game coming to Switch, not the remake. I will warn everyone, there will be a significant learning curve going from the more modern Fire Emblem games to this one. There are a few good updates to the original game that will help modern players adjust to the now 30-year-old systems. The game now has the ability to rewind turns, much like Milla's turn wheel from Shadows of Valentia, although it's unclear if it is limited in use at all, like the turn wheel. And also, you can now bookmark saves during battles. These additions will make the game more accessible and easier to handle, but the core gameplay and systems have not changed, so the challenge will remain, and the new stuff is optional if you want to play it like it was 1990. With all this said, why would people, myself included, be excited about playing a 30-year-old game that has already been remade previously? There are a few reasons, and I'll start with the ones relating to the game itself, and then transition into talking about what this release means for Fire Emblem as a whole. Firstly, while Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light doesn't have the weapon triangles, support conversations, personal or support skills, etc., the core tactical gameplay remains. I think it'll be fun to play the more stripped-down version, relying on more careful tactics that are necessary nowadays with all the new advantages for your troops. There are likely to be moments of frustration when I try to steer my brain away from my usual line of thinking when it comes to Fire Emblem, but I'm hoping the excitement of these strategic battles will help soothe over those moments. The second reason I'm excited for the game is as a history lesson for the series. I enjoy seeing how game series develop over time, and getting to play the original game of one of my favorite video game series of all time is something I never thought would happen. I've deliberately kept myself away from the original games in the series either for spoiler reasons or because I could play the remakes, so getting to see how the game plays and compare it to the rest of the series, and the remake especially, will be a treat. It might even give me new perspective on units and characters that I overlooked in my Shadow Dragon playthrough, which was a decently long time ago. This reason is likely not enticing to those people who aren't already big Fire Emblem fans, but honestly, I think that's pretty much what this release is supposed to be. For big Fire Emblem fans. That leads to my final reason I'm excited for the game, what it means for the future of Fire Emblem. As I just said, I see this release as a gift to longtime fans of the series, designed for that crowd. I wouldn't blame you if you only just got into the series and don't particularly want to play a game without a lot of the modern appeal and conveniences found in entries like Three Houses. However, Intelligent Systems and Nintendo's willingness and ability to do a port like this raises the question of whether they would do that for other Japan-only Fire Emblem games. Of the six games of the series produced first exclusively for Japan, three have had remakes and only two of those have come to the West. Ports like this one could offer another way for the developers to give Western Fire Emblem fans a chance to play through the Jugdral games or Binding Blade without having a full-scale remake. They could even throw in Mystery of the Emblem, the game that had a remake that didn't make it to the West. I'm not saying they will do that, but the possibility is now there, especially if Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light does well. Even if this turns out to be a one-time thing, this release shows that Intelligent Systems is still interested in giving English-speaking Fire Emblem fans access to the earlier games. I will always support greater access to Fire Emblem games, and I'm glad that another door has opened for fans to experience the first Fire Emblem game without resorting to emulation. However, this does lead to my one critique of the port, and that is, of course, the limited availability of this release. Yes, you can buy Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light for $5.99 US dollars from the eShop, but you must buy before March 31st, 2021, before it disappears from the shop forever. For an older game like this, limited availability for physical release is understandable, because some of these older ports don't even get a physical release at all. This game does, by the way. Limited availability for digital release makes absolutely no sense, and the choice to continue the practice after Super Mario 3D All-Stars pulled the same crap is ridiculous. Nintendo apparently hates money, and this nonsensical decision tempers my excitement somewhat, as it makes me think that those future ports I'd hoped for of Nintendo's massive back catalog of amazing games would be subjected to the same arbitrary restrictions. Nintendo, for all its incredible qualities, still has some very anti-customer practices, and I hate to see them crop up again. Sorry to end on a down note, but I can't talk about the game upcoming without mentioning this perplexing decision. All in all, though, the opportunity to experience Marth's first adventure in its original glory, plus some good additions to help keep the experience fresh, is one I'm really excited for. Getting some taste of the Fire Emblem content I enjoy is great, and I expect that even though the game will likely show its age in numerous ways, the core experience is fun enough to keep me entertained. Hopefully, it will tide us over until the next big installment in the series comes later down the line. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please give it a like in order to stop the YouTube algorithm from making this video a limited digital release, and comment below your thoughts on the video, the game, or anything else. Subscribe to keep up with future videos. I hope you have a great day, and happy gaming!